Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Mary Kite, and I'm here representing the Board of Convention Affairs, and I'm delighted that Mary Lee Hummert has accepted our invitation to be a plenary speaker. Mary Lee is Professor of Communication Studies at University of Kansas, and she has a joint appointment in the Center for Gerontology there. And I want to begin the introduction with a little tiny excerpt from a poem, if that's okay. It's from Mae Swenson. It's easy to be young. Everybody is, at first. It's not easy to be old. It takes time. Youth is given. Age is achieved. Mary Lee has conducted groundbreaking interdisciplinary work on how our beliefs and attitudes about old age and how they focus on why we at once both do and do not believe that aging is an achievement. Her earlier work identified the subtypes we have of older adults, and this work directed our attention to the complexity of aging and the difference between golden agers and perfect grandparents compared to curmudgeons and despondent, lonely elders. She's made the connections between these beliefs and how older people are treated, and how negative and positive self-stereotypes influence the everyday lives of older people. Her high-impact scholarship is based on excellent methodology and is widely cited across disciplines. Her achievements have been recognized with the Byron A. Alexander Graduate Mentor Award, induction into the Kansas Women's Hall of Fame, fellow status in the Gerontological Society of America, and the Giles Nussbaum Distinguished Scholar Award from the National Communication Association. She's here to talk to us today about age stereotyping, communication, adult development, promoting well-being. So let's welcome Mary Lee. Thank you.
So I hope that you can all see the screen, and I do want to say thank you to Mary for that very kind and generous introduction, and my thanks also to all of you who have come inside from this beautiful afternoon to listen to this presentation. Okay, so this afternoon I'd like to cover three major topics: age stereotypes and how they relate to adult development, age stereotyping and self-stereotyping as they emerge in the communication process, and covering the other topics that are listed on the screen as we move through this, and then conclude with some implications for effective communication. So, I have approached the study of age stereotypes and communication from a social, cognitive, and developmental framework. And from that framework, stereotypes are viewed as cognitive constructs or beliefs about the characteristics of members of social groups. Stereotyping, in contrast, is a process. It's a process of drawing on those constructs in our perception of other people and in our interactions with them. Self-stereotyping, similarly, is also a process, but it's a process of then applying those constructs to our own self in terms of our perceptions of ourself and our self-presentation to others. Development includes the physical and psychological changes that occur to each of us over our lifespan from both maturational processes and individual experiences. And from the research that I'm going to talk about, what we can see is that those developmental processes also play into what our age stereotypes are, and then how they might be involved in self-stereotyping and stereotyping of other people. So what are the similarities and differences in age stereotypes across the adult age range. One thing we do know, and Mary referenced that in her introduction, is that regardless of how old we are, we have both positive conceptions about aging and negative conceptions. But when we ourselves traverse through the lifespan, our experiences and our own interactions with people who are aging affects the nature of those stereotypes, not in terms of making them more positive, but in causing us to think in richer, more complex terms about what age stereotypes are. So Mary mentioned several stereotypes that we've identified in our research, and these are stereotypes that I've termed cultural archetypes in a way, because they are shared by young adults, people in middle age, and on through the older age ranges. Severely impaired, I should say that the characteristics emerged from the participants in our study, we applied the labels to them. So a severely impaired type person, despondent, shrew curmudgeon, of course none of us are ever going to be a shrew curmudgeon, right? And then positive ones, this is where we all see ourselves, golden ager, perfect grandparent, of course, and John Wayne conservative. So you can tell from that last label that we conducted the research, and as you can see on the screen, in the early 90s when people still knew who John Wayne was. And in terms of complexity, what we found was, and you see some examples here, middle-aged and older participants made finer discriminations among types of older people. So on the negative side, we have mildly impaired, self-centered, coming from both our middle-aged and older participants, and then only from the older participants, an elitist type of person. And there were similar discriminations in terms of more richer, positive stereotypes as well. So we know we have positive and negative age stereotypes, but when we look at research that has examined evaluations of older people in comparison to younger ones, particularly reviews, meta-analyses, and Mary Kite has done some fabulous work in this area as well. So what we see is that negative stereotypes seem to predominate. They seem to have more of an influence on perceptions than positive ones. So in addition to this research, the method, when we think about this and we think about the method that I and my colleagues used in investigating age stereotypes, we really asked them in a way, we didn't say what your stereotypes are, but we asked them to, we gave them sets of traits and they sorted them into different types of older individuals. Well, this means that they were thinking consciously about what their stereotypes are. There is quite a bit of other research that shows that the ways in which stereotypes might emerge and influence our perceptions is implicitly or outside our conscious awareness. We're not really thinking about stereotypes. So one possible explanation for why negative stereotypes seem to predominate over positive ones may lie in this idea of implicit or more automatic stereotyping of older people. So in one study, we actually looked at and tried to measure implicit positive and negative age stereotypes with participants who were more college age, young adults, middle aged, young old individuals, and old. And and often in studies, young old is defined as, say, from the age 60 through 74, old, 75 and above. So we measured their implicit stereotypes and tried to compare the positive stereotype of older people as wise to the negative stereotype of older people as more closed in terms of their willingness to embrace new experiences, et cetera. And to measure the implicit stereotypes, we used the implicit association test developed by Greenwald, McGee, and Schwartz in 1998. Yeah, so I don't know if you have, any of you have participated and taken an implicit association test, but I thought I'd give you a little mini experience of what we asked our participants to do in this study. So what you see on the screen, you see the word open on the right hand and the word, open on the left and closed on the right. And in the middle of the screen, when I hit the magic button, there will appear a word, and your task is to categorize it as either a trait of a person who's open or a trait of a person who's closed. And of course, when we do this with our participants, we use a computer keyboard or buttons. I'm going to, rather than pass them out to you and give you each a computer to do this, I will just ask you to hit your left knee if it's a word, a trait associated with being open. Yes. I get confused when I look from here to there, so I'm not going to look over there. Left knee if it's an open trait, right knee if it's a closed trait. Are you ready? Okay, here we go. All right, very, very good, very good. On this next task, there will be a photo that appears in the center of the screen. It will either be a photo of an old person or a photo of a young person. If it's a young person, left knee. If it's an old person, right knee. Here we go. Very, very good. And now we're going to, as Emerald would say, kick it up a notch. And if it's, there will be either a photo or a trait that appears in the middle of the screen. If it's a photo of a young person or an open trait, your left knee. If it's a photo of an old person or a closed trait, your right knee. Okay, very, very good job. This is going to be your last task. Now, again, it'll be either a photo or a trait. If it's a photo of an old person or an opened trait, then your left knee. If it's a photo of a young person or a closed trait, your right knee. Ready? All right, so the last two tasks are the real heart of the implicit association test. And it's possible that one of those was easier for you than the other. So the third task, the one was young paired with open or old paired with closed, would would be one that would be, we would say, was stereotype consistent in terms of our cultural expectations about differences between young and older people, whereas the last one would be stereotype inconsistent. And that forces us, sometimes means that it takes us a little bit longer to make the correct response. The implicit association measure, or the IAT effect, is computed as the response time to that last stereo inconsistent task minus the response time to what we would say would be the stereotype consistent task. And it's interpreted in that a larger IAT effect indicates a stronger implicit association. And I want to emphasize that that doesn't mean it's higher bias or that it's greater prejudice, just that the strength of the association in terms of how long it takes us to respond is stronger for the stereotype consistent than for the stereotype inconsistent. So what did we find when we looked at the results with our participants? On the right side of your screen, you can see four bars that are all pretty high and they're not significantly different from one another. So that is the stereotype of older people as closed, the negative stereotype, equally strong across our the four age groups in this particular study. On the left side, you see three smaller bars. Those were the positive stereotype of older people as wise. And you only really see bars for the middle-aged, the young old, and the old participants. The young participants in this study responded, when I think of it in this way, they responded equally quickly or to old people as wise and young people as wise. So they found it very difficult to really distinguish that older, respond more quickly that older people are wise in comparison to young people as wise. And I'm simplifying it a little bit, but that's one way to look at the data. So when we think about results like this, what are the implications for age stereotyping in communication? One is that communication with older individuals may be susceptible to the influence of implicit negative stereotypes more than positive ones. And that may be particularly true for younger people in comparison to older people. So this process and the consequences have been conceptualized in the communication predicament of aging model developed by Ryan, Giles, Bartolucci, and Henwood. It was initially published in 1986, and it has had a great deal of influence on research in the communication and aging area. It is really based on a theory developed by Howard Giles called the communication accommodation theory. So I want to kind of take you through this particular model. The model suggests that when we encounter an older person, we might attend to categorical cues to their age. Those cues could be physical, they could be contextual. So meeting somebody in an assisted living center may be more likely to make us conscious of their age than meeting them here at the APA convention. They could also be communicative, and I'll talk about that a little bit later, but there are communication strategies that we associate more with negative age stereotypes than with positive ones. So those particular cues, the model says, may lead to some stereotyped expectations about what would be effective in communicating with this person. And we might then modify our speech behavior in order to meet those stereotyped expectations. That has been associated with a type of communication that has been termed patronizing talk or elder speak. And the characteristics are ones that we might use, or the strategies are ones that we might use for somebody who is having some cognitive challenges or has some declines in hearing. So we may, if we just accommodate to this particular stereotype, engage in exaggerated intonation, might speak more slowly, we may use more simplified language, avoid very complex topics. You can read through the list. Collectively, what that those sorts of adaptations do is they communicate to this person that we don't have a very high sense of their competence. We could be encouraging dependence. We may not be speaking to them in a respectful way, or the sorts of communication that we associate with normal adult-to-adult talk. At an extreme, this could devolve into what has been termed by Linda Caperell secondary baby talk. At another extreme, it can be very direct and controlling. Control is often a very large part of what we have termed elder speak or patronizing talk. So I'm going to skip through this next slide, but I'll just let you hear
a little bit. You have to tell them. If you don't tell them, I will. I swear. You have to tell them you're too smart to get to do something like that. I mean, I can understand someone with a weak disposition, afraid. You're not afraid of anything. You owe it to yourself. You've got to be perfectly well when you walk out of here. Do you want to go home and start your social life all over again and within 3 or 4 days be back here? What a waste of time. What a waste of money. You cannot do that. You must tell the nurses, and I swear to you, if you don't, I will.
So this is just an example of one message that we collected in a study, and this particular message was directed to somebody who was presented with the characteristics that we associate with a golden ager. But the context was a hospital. So I think it illustrates this is not a very extreme example of patronizing talk or elder speak. It's more moderate, but it occurred primarily when this golden ager individual was presented in a hospital context. So obviously I didn't skip it. The real danger with this form of communication is its potential to reinforce stereotypes both in the person who receives it and in the person who uses it. And together, this can contribute to self-stereotyping on the part of the older person and increased stereotyping on the part of the younger person, or actually could be a person of the same age, and contribute and really start a very destructive, negative feedback cycle that has can have actually influence functional decline in older individuals. So there have been many studies that have looked at various steps in the communication predicament of aging model, but I'd like to highlight just some effects that document its potential to contribute to age-related changes that are of concern. I'm sure many of you are familiar with the work of Margaret Baltus. I'm just focusing here on one result that actually led then to some interventions to actually improve the function for individuals living in nursing homes. But the observation that nursing home staff really were encouraging dependent behaviors, they found was associated with functional declines in those residents. And when they were able to introduce training to get the staff to encourage independence, they showed improvement in functional measures. In experimental studies, we found that, this is not my research, but Susan Kemper's research and Brian O'Connell's research, that those addressed in elder speak in comparison to other participants had lower evaluations of their own communication skills and lower self-esteem after being addressed in elder speak. And my colleague, Christy Williams at the University of Kansas Medical Center has done several studies, including intervention studies with staff in nursing homes. And in comparison to normal staff talk or even silence, the use of elder speak increased the probability of disruptive behaviors by residents with dementia. So there is evidence for the communication predicament of aging model. So this is a measure, the model really focuses on stereotyping. And for all of us, it's useful to think about ways in which we communicate that might contribute to that stereotyping. Several studies have examined the communication behaviors of older people and those of younger people, and looked at how they might be associated with either positive age stereotypes or negative ones. On the positive side, and I'll highlight just a couple here. One is that when stories told by older people just in conversation have been then compared to stories told by young people, those told by the older participants have been judged as more interesting, and in particular also more likely to provide worthwhile insights. Some of the other behaviors associated with the positive stereotypes, I think, are ones that we would associate with positive communication from someone of any age. On the right side, with the negative communication behaviors, are those communication behaviors associated with negative age stereotypes. Lack of affect, rambling, repeating stories, complaining, talking about health problems or losses, particularly in interactions with relative strangers. That has been seen as and termed positive, painful self-disclosures. All of those behaviors are associated more with negative age stereotypes. And we might say, well, yes, I know young people who constantly repeat their stories. The problem is that we don't associate that sort of behavior with young people as a whole, whereas we may associate it with older people as a whole. So we were interested in how those communication behaviors that are variably associated with positive and negative age stereotypes might interact with implicit stereotypes to affect evaluations of an older person, as well as what we might offer them in terms of advice. And we tested this developmental hypothesis in that in comparison to older participants, younger ones' evaluations would show more influence of negative stereotypes than of the communication style that the person was using. Yeah, and we did this in a study with young, middle-aged, and older participants. We presented them with the same woman speaking in either what we called a age-positive communication style or an age-negative style, and collected their evaluations of her competence, her characteristics, and what advice they would give her in a decision that she was making. The scenario that they used, they watched a video of two women, one younger, one older, having a conversation. They were volunteers working for Habitat for Humanity. They were just putting together flyers to be sent out. And the participants we were asking for their judgments about the friendship that might develop between these two women. They were told that they were to focus on the one woman that they were observing and that other people would be observing the other one. So I want to show you a couple clips. Those of you who were here earlier saw one of them. And then we'll talk about the results.
A couple of our grandchildren work with us painting a house one summer, and my husband doesn't remember that at all, you know. And it's very difficult talking to him sometimes. People say it only get worse. Maybe he might not, someday he might not even remember me. And I don't know how I'm going to handle that. I don't know if I even am handling this very well.
And this is a little bit later in the same conversation.
You know, I was thinking that maybe one of the reasons why people stay so involved, you know, you're doing something very helpful, but you're also having fun while you're doing it.
Yeah. Boy, ouch. It even hurts to hold a pen today. See how my fingers are swollen?
You're right.
All right. And so this is the positive conversation. Whoops. Okay.
You know, I was thinking that maybe one of the reasons why people stay so involved, you know, you're doing something very helpful, but you're also having fun while you're doing it.
Yeah. Sorry. Boy,
this
ouch.
Is the same one.
It even hurts to hold a pen today. See how my fingers are swollen?
That was a
You're
repeat.
Right.
Apologies.
You know, I was thinking that maybe.
Okay, now we'll try it.
You know, that's what makes it so much fun. A couple of my grandchildren came over to help us paint the house. Well, I don't know which got the most paint, the house or the grandchildren or my husband. What a mess that was.
Well, at least they had a good time.
Yeah.
I was thinking this may be one of the reasons why people stay involved. You know, you're doing something helpful, and you're also having fun while you're doing it.
Yeah, and you see that you've actually accomplished something. This is very important. There's a house sitting there that wasn't there when you started, and you helped a happy family to move in.
You're right.
So when we looked at the results, we found support for the developmental hypothesis. In comparison to the middle-aged and older participants, the younger participants were less sensitive to the communication style, whether they saw the positive communication style or the negative communication style video, they judged the woman's competence more negatively than did the middle-aged and older participants. And critically, the stronger their implicit stereotypes, the less likely the young participants were to discriminate. Well, they didn't really see both of them. More similarly, they judged both the positive and the negative communication style, whereas middle-aged and older participants were more likely to attend to the differences between the I shouldn't say it that way. They were more sensitive to style, I guess, in their judgments. And the more positively they evaluated the older woman, the more likely they were to offer advice that encouraged her to be independent in terms of this decision. So that's all relates to the stereotyping process. How might self-stereotyping affect our behaviors? Much of the research has looked at the negative stereotype of memory, and because it's such a strong stereotype about aging. And those studies have found that those older persons who are either subliminally or explicitly exposed to the negative age stereotype about memory then have poorer memory performance than do other participants who were exposed to positive age stereotypes. Becca Levy, who is noted for her research on self-stereotyping, has done analyses of longitudinal data sets, and has those analyses have shown more positive outcomes in terms of health for individuals who, from the time they were young, have had more positive self-perceptions about aging than for those who, from the time they were young, held more negative perceptions about aging. And that extended even to mortality risk. Because of this sort of research, there's been a great deal of interest in what sorts of influences there might be that may lead us to self-stereotype. One is that we start to identify as older, or that we have an older subjective age. In other words, we feel more like we see ourselves as closer to our chronological age than to some ideal age, and that has been thought of as one kind of influence that might lead us to engage in self-stereotyping. There has been a relatively recent development of this idea of age stereotype domains, meaning that there are some areas of our life that are more strongly associated with negative stereotypes than with positive ones. Friends and acquaintances, personality, way of living, finances, and of course the physical and appearance domains are associated more with negative stereotypes, and may be domains in which when we find ourselves in those domains, we might be more susceptible to self-stereotyping. And those are opposed to other domains like family, spirituality, work, in which we don't have those strong negative stereotypes. And so they might buffer us. Being in those domains, we might view ourselves more positively. And then another recent construct, awareness of age-related change, or AARC, has kind of tried to identify what sorts of experiences or events trigger in us, make our age and our place in the lifespan more salient to us. And those sorts of situations, particularly if they're ones that we see as unwanted, then those might make us more susceptible to self-stereotyping. But I would like to talk about how we do it to ourselves. You know, how do we self-stereotype in our communication with other people? Using age as an excuse or an explanation, even in jest. You know, how many times have you heard somebody say, oh, what is his name? I must be having a senior moment. And even if they don't use senior moment, they attribute that lack to age. Discussing health problems. I don't know if you've had the experience of sitting on a plane with somebody who all of a sudden just starts talking about the treatment that they're undergoing, or tells a very sad story about a loss of a dear friend or a spouse. This it certainly would trigger stereotyping in the other person, but it also reinforces for the speaker their own losses with age. Drawing attention to age differences between you and your communication partners. For those of us who work with many young people, we may not do this, but sometimes we might. We might point out, when I went up for tenure, these were the standards. Or, no, we didn't have to do that. But by doing that, we make ourselves more conscious of age. Complaining about young people today or changing standards, none of us would do that. And then introducing comparisons to the past and ourselves in those past situations. So there was a great cartoon that appeared on an editorial page when John Glenn, at about age 80, went up in the space shuttle, and it showed him saying, oh, in my day we didn't have any of this Tang, and no, none of that internet stuff, no astronaut ice cream. And so the point of the cartoon was really that the other astronauts were saying, oh my God, it's going to be a long trip. But yeah, that's funny. But then you think about the fact that if he hadn't said those things, they would maybe not have thought that too. So, and it's the possibility that each time we engage in that sort of talk, we are reminding ourselves of age and its importance in our lives. So what are the implications for effective communication? Certainly stereotyping and self-stereotyping can be unconscious and driven by the best intentions. Communication, by nature, is in the moment, right? We don't have a lot of time to plan our regular talk with our friends and colleagues and family. And that makes it especially vulnerable to implicit stereotyping, to self-stereotyping, and the associated risks. Therefore, it's especially important that we are aware of our own communication and for each of us, regardless of age. Strategies to reduce stereotyping and self-stereotyping. Certainly developing that awareness of our own constructs, the way we normally talk, and especially in context associated with negative age stereotypes. Trying to avoid, I talk about the fact that we used young, middle-aged, and older participants in our studies, but each of those young people was different from all of the other ones, the same for middle-aged, same for the older, and our groupings are arbitrary, right, based upon chronological age. We have to fight this tendency to talk about getting older and using phrases like senior moments. Even jokingly, I would say even with our friends who are in the same age group. And there's a general semantic strategy called indexing. And indexing is a strategy to just say, hey, just because this person is the way they are doesn't mean that this person is young, doesn't mean that they're all young people are in, the same, or the same with older people. Or for myself, just because I forgot something today, that doesn't mean that I'm going to do it tomorrow. And also, it doesn't mean that I never forgot anything before. And listening actively is quite important. Just paying attention to how other people are responding might cause us to reconsider a phrasing. I think this is especially important when we have been unwittingly engaging in elder speak or patronizing talk. We might be able to see how people react and be able to adjust and repair that accordingly. So, in summary, for adults of all ages, negative age stereotypes are more accessible than positive stereotypes. I wish it was the other way around, but it's not. Those stereotypes can creep in even when we don't want them to and affect our perceptions and our interactions. Because communication is so in the moment, it does make it especially susceptible, I think, to implicit stereotyping. And attention to our own communication stereotypes, to our own communication strategies, can help to interrupt that sort of implicit operation. In terms of some closing thoughts, remember the CPA model, communication predicament of aging. Accommodations to negative age stereotypes can lead to a destructive communication cycle that encourages stereotyping and self-stereotyping. The best hope for countering age stereotypes and promoting positive stereotypes in our interactions is heightened awareness, building positive intergenerational relationships with assertiveness and sensitivity, and making conscious efforts to eliminate stereotyping and self-stereotyping in our own communication. Paying attention to our attributions about others' behaviors and our own, and trying to avoid those internal attributions, especially to age, is a worthy goal. And I don't know about you, but I've decided that the next time that I forget something or I skip a slide, I think I will just say, I'm having a freshman moment. So thank you for your attention. You've been a great audience. And I'm very happy to answer any questions. Yes. Oh, there is, yeah.
Some of those, and right. I don't know how much empirical evidence there is for it.
Yeah. Right. There is another one called the communication enhancement model, too, that tries to flip it as well. So, yeah. Yes.
I noticed that all the pictures you were using
I'm sorry? Yes, yes. Well, yeah, they were all from around Kansas, so that is a very good point, and I think that we really haven't done the research that we need to do to really look at the extent to which these, certainly the images cross different cultures. I do have, we have done some research, well, actually, with one of my colleagues who is from the People's Republic of China, and haven't done the same sorts of research. We have done research on the stereotypes and on the communication strategies. So there are some cultural differences in terms of what constitutes, say, a communication strategy more associated with the negative than the positive, but the general valence difference is the same. Now, we haven't really looked at the physical features of aging and how they differ across different cultures. Even the big sets of photographs are primarily from Europe, right? European. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Right, right. Well, it is probably part of the lifespan process, but the big difference is that when we're young, we know we're going, time's up, going to get older. And so when we get to the older age range, there's no going back, right? And so there's the assumption may be that change isn't possible or that things aren't going to get better, whereas for younger people, that's not the case. So I think our time is up. I don't know why, but I think that.